Well, good afternoon. My name is Melanie Lowe. I am a professor of musicology here at Vanderbilt at the Blair School of Music. I'm an 18th century specialist, and I have a quick question before we get started. I see at least one Blair student out there, maybe a couple. Are there any Blair parents in the audience? A few people? All right. I probably had all your kids at some point. Hopefully what I do today will give you a little taste of what I do professionally at conferences, papers, publications, that sort of thing, but also some of how I teach my students. I like to bring in my work professionally in the field into my classroom so that there's a kind of nice mingling of ideas, things that are tangible that students can take with them as they go and make their way in the world as musicians and educated people, but also something that I find stimulating, something that gets me excited, hopefully will get them excited as well. So what I'm going to talk to you today about is a piece of music called Haydn's Creation, The Creation, an Oratorio by Haydn. So we'll get going. There will be a little bit of interaction, some time for question and answers at the end. But if in the middle, anything you want to talk about, feel free to just pretend that you're in my classroom. Raise your hand, and we'll get going. Yeah?
Well, let's just start right off.
Okay.
I just wanted to know about how long the class will be.
About how long the class will be. Under an hour. Oops, if I can stay standing.
So we can make the ceremony at
Does it start at 3?
Yes.
Okay, you know what? It's just about under an hour, so we should probably really get going.
So you don't have
but
to
I will do my best. If you need to go, I will not be offended.
That's
the main thing.
Sneak out.
Not a problem. It'll be just like in one of my classrooms. Okay. Because actually, a lot of students have to go back and forth between Blair and Wilson, and we get it. We totally get it. So, all right, well, let's get going then. 1797, Joseph Haydn completed what was immediately hailed as his greatest work, The Creation. An oratorio that was scored for orchestra, for chorus, and for soloists that tells the story of the creation of the world as it is relayed in the book of Genesis and in Milton's Paradise Lost. And in this faculty seminar, I hope to introduce you to a great piece of music as well as give you some sense of the philosophical questions that arise when we approach such an enormous piece of music that deals with such lofty themes. It's about 2 hours long. It's enormous. It's wonderful. But when we approach this piece from the vantage point of even 215 years later, big questions can come up when we think about a work like this. Haydn's oratorio opens with nothing short of a musical impossibility, the sound of infinite nothingness. What does nothing sound like? Well, the obvious answer would be silence. Don't all pieces of music start with silence? I mean, at least in the abstract, if not in the reality of performance, what precedes the opening bar? Well, if you look at the page, the score, the piece of music, nothing. I mean, nothing precedes the opening bar. Well, the margin of the page, but that's really it. So, nothing. Well, what precedes the opening bar in performance? We've got the sound of the orchestra tuning. We've got the sound of the audience murmuring, and hopefully the sound of cell phones powering down, that little chiming twinkle we get. We get cough drop rappers and program rattlings. But it's not silence, not by any stretch of the musical imagination. Well, other than perhaps John Cage's imagination, that would be music. But from most musical perspectives, it's not silence. But that kind of nothing, that kind of silence, could never depict the awesome nothingness that preceded God's creation of the heavens and the earth. What would that kind of nothing sound like? It's practically impossible in the human imagination to contemplate a depiction of nothingness without calling up sound, or rather, the absence of sound. There's a famous statement by mathematician Blaise Pascal that captures perfectly our human linking of silence with nothingness. In his most important theological work, The Pensée, or in English, Thoughts, he wrote, "The eternal silence of these infinite spaces terrifies me. It would seem that the absence of sound, more than any other physical stimulus, has particular resonance with nothingness. The absence of light, for example, darkness, summons more sinister connotations. In the absence of taste or touch or smell, well, these seem not to resonate at all." As music philosopher Stan Link puts it, who's also on the faculty here, I should add, he puts it like this: quietness evokes nothingness as pointedly as human perception might allow. But now wait a minute. Quietness is not the same thing as silence. And it's precisely quietness, not silence, that Haydn so effectively uses to depict the awesome nothingness of the void. Sorry, Pascal, you wrote it off the island. Let's listen to the opening of the Creation and hear this quietness. But two caveats before I hit play. First of all, the Creation actually begins not quietly. It begins with a mighty and oppressive unison C played by nearly the full orchestra. And then second, the opening number of the Creation is actually not titled The Void Before Creation. It's titled much more plainly. It's titled The Representation of Chaos. So here's the beginning of Haydn's oratorio, The Creation. Donald Francis Tovey, who was a great British music analyst, perfectly captured the sentiment of Haydn's opening. He wrote in exclamation, "Here is your infinite empty space." And indeed, the first note of the piece is simply a unison C. No harmony, no dissonance, no melody as close to the void as music can get. This opening note is also truly sublime. Its ominous and primordial feeling is generated by a bizarre timbral mixture in its orchestration. We get brass on middle C, sometimes doubled at the trumpets and at the octave. We get winds on Cs above and below middle C. We get muted strings no higher than middle C, and a timpani roll on C underneath all of it. Dynamically, Haydn calls for a great decrescendo on this note, from forte all the way down to piano, while acknowledging, in the musical notation at least, that this sound, the sound of infinite nothingness, the sound of the infinite space of the void, this existed indefinitely. This opening note enjoys the only fermata in the entire representation of chaos. To end it requires intervention. A directive from an all-powerful being, a god perhaps, or at least a baton-wielding conductor. In the music that follows the sublime opening, however, Haydn gives us a better sense of how he understood, or defined even, the chaos of the earth without form as it is mentioned and called in Genesis 1:2. For Haydn, chaos was clearly not understood in a more conventional way, meaning as disorder. Rather, chaos was that infinite space that echoes the eerie quietness of the unformed matter that preceded creation. In the music that follows Haydn's infinite fade to black, unison C, Haydn assembles the raw materials of music before our ears. We hear two notes that create an interval, and then another note joins to create a chord. But it's not a tonic chord, it's not a dominant chord. In other words, it defines neither of the harmonic pillars that are very important in establishing a tonal center, tonality being the language of the common practice period. Moreover, the music that immediately follows this chord is extraordinarily unusual for the conventions of the time. We have this unresolved dissonance and an unaccompanied melodic fragment that lead only to yet another iteration of the as yet structurally undefined chord. Haydn's audience would have been incapable of anticipating the direction of this music, and therefore incapable of finding any rational meaning in it. This irrationality is the void, and it is not a silent place, but rather a quietness that's filled with a primordial stew of the ingredients of music, elements that Haydn then uses to fill the void, thereby reenacting musically before our ears the miraculous process of creation itself. Let me play the opening of Chaos one more time for you. So what, then, is chaotic about Haydn's representation of chaos? Well, if we cling to a conventional conception of chaos, meaning disorder, then not very much, actually. Structurally, for those of you that have some musical background, or certainly my students should know this, the movement is easily analyzed as a slow-movement sonata form. And even as early in the 1880s, some Philistine, as Donald Francis Tovey called him, this Philistine wrote in the New Grove, or then was just the Grove Dictionary of Music and Musicians, that Haydn's creation represented chaos by means of an exceedingly unchaotic fugue. But it is Haydn himself, actually, who gives us the best answer to this question. What is so chaotic about his representation of chaos? After playing the movement at the piano for the suite of Chargé d'Affaires, he explained, "You have certainly noticed how I avoided the resolutions that you would most readily expect. The reason is that there is no form in anything in the universe yet." In essence, by his own explanation, Haydn represents chaos by denying the harmonic expectations of late 18th century musical style. Not just to our ears then, you know, positioned as we are 215 years later, but both to Haydn's ear and to the ears of his original audience, the representation of chaos is hardly chaotic. But philosophically, anyway, the notion of chaos remains literally, by definition, unthinkable. But to represent chaos in music in a way that the listener's merely human mind is capable of grasping, that can hardly be chaotic. Indeed, an artistic representation of chaos would seem an ontological impossibility, for it would require art to embody something that's really antithetical to art, and that would be disorder. In the representation of chaos, then, Haydn uses the means of art to thwart the ends of art, which is really absolutely masterful. But while such a lack of musical chaos might work brilliantly to represent chaos in the opening 6 minutes of the creation, an absence of conflict, or at least something resembling a chaotic moment, when you have an absence of this over the course of a 2-hour work, you have a greater conflict in place. To speak to that particular challenge, to work with 2 hours of time and a story and a piece of music that has at its core no conflict, how do you keep that moving? How do you generate interest? That's something of a conflict right there. But to introduce you to kind of the problems that arise with that, I have to tell you a little bit more about this piece. So I want to introduce you to the structure of the oratorio as a whole, get into a couple of specific little spots, and then we'll return to this larger question afterwards. So what's on the next slide is the structural design of the whole piece. The creation libretto, meaning the text that is actually sung, it's got three parts. which include a total of 10 scenes in them. Parts 1 and 2 follow the biblical account of creation, while part 3 introduces Adam and Eve as they discover this newly created world and give thanks to God. Narratively speaking, it's pretty straightforward stuff. The text itself is made up of quotations from the Old Testament, specifically from the first and second chapters of Genesis and the 19th and 104th Psalms. And along with the third part is made up with texts that are mostly drawn or derivative from Milton's epic poem. So I like to think that the first two parts are Bible-heavy, and the last part is all Milton. The creation libretto is also supremely logical. So within this larger tripartite structure, every single day of creation, and in the biblical account there are 6 days of creation, every single day is treated as a group of movements or musical numbers, and each group follows the same basic structural pattern. What we get is a recitation of the appropriate verse from Genesis, which is sung by one of the angels, Raphael, Uriel, or Gabriel. And these biblical recitatives, this is on the left side of the slide now, the biblical recitatives are then followed by this amplification of the verse, a kind of explanation, poetry that tries to kind of be like Milton but doesn't quite get there. But anyway, so, you know, kind of explaining, amplifying what was suggested in the verse. And then each day ends with a rather large chorus, a movement of praise that is sung by soloists and the chorus together. And part three, even though we are done creating things, part three still maintains this kind of structural pattern to it. So the whole thing is really supremely logical. So for example, if you see the right side of the slide now, on the second day of creation, just to give you one example, we are, as we are told in Genesis, and here is recited by the angel Raphael, God made the firmament and divided the waters. Let me just give you a sense of what that actually sounds like. So here's a recitation, a recitative of this biblical verse in the middle of this giant oratorio. Here that is. And then immediately following that, Raphael, the angel, expounds on this verse, adding textual details that lend themselves easily to musical depiction. Here's where the real fun begins. So, for example, Raphael will tell of outrageous storms and howling winds, heaven's fire, which is lightning, and rolling thunder, rain showers, dreary, wasteful hail. We've had some of that here lately. Light, flaky snow. And Haydn not only captures the essence of each aspect of nature as it is created, but he plays a little game with the listener. He paints the musical depiction before Raphael the angel names it, inviting us to try to guess which element is being illustrated. So here, for example, are the storms and winds with the clouds rolling in before the creation of dry land. Which bring with them lightning and thunder. And after that come other weather phenomena, and I thought we should actually play along. Let's take Haydn up on his brilliant invitation to predict the weather based on skilled observation. In other words, let's play musical weatherman. It's going to hail, it's going to snow, it's going to rain. I want to know if you can predict the order of precipitation from the musical cues. This, after all, is what the composer of this piece is asking you to do, and I'll tell you why in about 10 minutes. But anyway, here's the first precipitation event. I put it in score, but you can just use your ears. It's one of those three things. I'd like to know which one it sounds like. Here's the first one. Mm-hmm. you think? Hail? Not hail? Snow? Rain? I'm hearing rain or snow. How many for rain? How many for snow? Okay, let's keep it open. I'm getting half and half. Let's keep going. Eventually, we'll get it right. Here's the next one. Oh, I messed up. Sorry. Wait, I have to do the slide again. Sorry. My bad. Let's try it again. Too much excitement. All right, here's the first one again. We're going back and forth. Rain, snow, or rain, hail. No, rain, snow, rain, snow. And the second one, here we go. What do you think? Snow, rain, hail? How about the second one? Hail? They're going with hail? All right, here's the last one. Isn't it pretty? Does that sound like light and flaky snow? All right, musical meteorologists, what is the order of precipitation in Haydn's Creation?
Rain,
hail, snow. You got it. Bravo. All right, so once the division of the waters, if you read your Genesis, that's what happens. The waters are divided into things like rain, and well, they're divided, that's all we know, but the librettists here decided they're divided into rivers and brooks and rain and snow and hail and all that good stuff. So once the division of the waters has been accomplished, Gabriel the archangel joins the chorus to sing, to praise God for all the work he did on the second day. What I'd like to do actually is play this number for you intact because we kind of chopped it up. And I'd like you to hear it uninterrupted so that you can hear the depiction of the weather phenomena before they are actually named in German, by the angel. And it's also a good way for you to get a sense of how this piece actually flows, because we're going to do this game again in just a minute. So for those of you that are unfamiliar with the piece, again, this is one of its primary modes of expression. You hear it before it's actually named, and you're invited to figure out what it is. So here's that whole movement without me blabbing over it. Sorry about that cadence. It immediately goes into the next piece. So hopefully that'll keep you wanting more, not satisfied. Okay. I'd like to look at one more instance of musical depiction. And this is from the sixth day. It's too much fun to leave out of a talk like this. As we're told in Genesis, on the sixth day, God said, "Let the earth bring forth the living creature after his kind, cattle and creeping things, the beasts of the earth after their kind." And in the amplification of the verse that follows, the animals are named. It's obvious that Haydn had loads of fun writing his musical depictions of animals because these depictions are mostly a mimicry of either the sounds or the motions of the animals. And as just with the weather phenomena, they're actually sounding before they're named. inviting us to guess, as we hear it, which animal it is before the angel names it. So here, for example, is the roar of a lion, and then the lion will be named. And now, a leaping tiger. Stag. The steed. You all on your horses? And then later in this number, which I'll play for you in a minute, you'll hear a host of buzzing insects, and then my personal favorite, the creeping worm, way underground. The only animals in this number that are not depicted by imitating their sounds are cattle and sheep. And this is actually something very interesting and ties into one of the bigger themes of the piece, so I want to take a moment and talk about it. To call up the image of these animals, he could have made like a lowing cow or a bleating sheep. I mean, that would have been easy to do. He does something very different. There's got to be a reason for it, because it's so easy to do it the other way. What he does instead is to tap into the musical conventions of the pastoral. And what I mean by that is a kind of literary genre that makes its way into music, and pieces of music that depict rural life, rustic life. The themes of the countryside. And here, what Haydn does is he taps wind instruments, in particular the flute and the bassoon. These are instruments that have an association with the outdoors, and they play this kind of serene and smooth melody in a Siciliano rhythm. Let me explain this rhythm first. The Siciliano rhythm sounds like this. Dum-da-da-dum, dum-da-da-dum. And it's a rhythm that is usually associated with pastoral themes and melancholy emotions. And a good way to think of this association is to hear the Christmas carol, Silent Night, in your head. Silent Night's a quiet, pastoral, melancholy little tune, and it uses a Siciliano rhythm. Bum, ba, ba, bum. Bum, ba, ba, bum. So keep that in mind, and listen to Haydn's pastoral setting for cattle and sheep. I want to play the whole number intact for you now, so you can play along with the guessing game, but also get a sense of how this stuff is structured. And remember, again, very important, the depiction happens first, and it's only named afterwards. So here it is, with the text in front of you. Come on.
Thank you.
a very low note to sing. That worm is very deep in the ground. So you can see with these two numbers, the division of the waters and the creation of some animals, the word painting in Haydn's Creation is a lot of fun, and it's very effective. Elsewhere in the oratorio, in many if not most of the musical numbers, Haydn adopts this pastoral mode, as we heard in the depiction of cattle and sheep. And as a musical signifier of naivete, the pastoral would seem opposed to the awesome sublimity of the topic of creation itself. And indeed, what Haydn is doing here is idealizing nature in the creation. And interestingly, in the two numbers that we've just looked at, he accomplishes this idealization not just by the musical representations, but how he structures this music. Some of his structural devices are really simple, others are subtle and more complex. But overall, his musical structures, when you really think about them, suggest that the naivete of the pastoral is really just a projection. As my colleague James Webster puts it, "Those sweetly mourning shepherds know more than they can say." Haydn's illustration of each natural phenomenon or animal is carried out through musical depictions that are immediately comprehensible to us humans, even though in the context of the creation story, no humans have been created yet. And this projection, this illusion of naivete, is accomplished through the musical structuring that we just heard. It's in Haydn's guessing games. It's the result of naming the event or the animal only after it has been imitated musically, only after inviting or even forcing the listener to focus entirely on the musical image, before that image has any verbal, that is human, signification, before it has a name that we've given it. And this simple structural device, a reversal of perhaps the more obvious structure, I think the more obvious one would be name it, play it. And he does the opposite. So the reversal suggests a certain subtle and sophisticated optimism that we humans, again, who have not yet been created, but we humans might identify directly with nature, unmediated by signification, while nature remains untainted, untouched, unspoiled, a perfect pastoral paradise. In other words, before we humans spoil it with either creations of our own or even our mere cognitive abilities. To finish up with structural matters, I'd actually like to indulge and play you one of the glorious choral numbers, because honestly, they're too good to leave out. These are these climactic moments that praise God at the end of sort of big days of creation. The most famous one comes at the end of the fourth day, and it's called "The Heavens Are Telling." And as you'll hear, it's triumphant, it's extroverted. And for those of you that might know Handel's oratorios or who know the Messiah, you will hear the spirit of Handel channeled through these moments. In this chorus, you'll also hear a big return to the sublime after all of this kind of pastoral stuff. So it's almost like Haydn is giving us these sublime frames for his pastoral pictures. Before I play the piece, though, I want to make just a couple of points about the sublime as an aesthetic category, because this ultimately is going to be very important to understand the final point that I'll make in just a few minutes. In a sense, the musical sublime that developed around the turn of the 19th century, around the time this piece was developed, this is part of an emerging romanticism. And in this romantic sense, the sublime is, like the pastoral, heavily invested in nature, but rather than invoking a kind of naivete or simplicity, the sublime looks to a boundless and untamed, awe-inspiring nature, a nature that is capable of inspiring transcendence. And for Haydn, these kind of violent or unexpected contrasts are a primary means of evoking the musical sublime. So before we actually get to the chorus I want to play you, let me show you the most famous instance of Haydn's sublime. This is the creation of light. So I'm going to take you back to the end of chaos for the creation of light. And I think the sublimity of the moment speaks for itself. It's accomplished through a rather shocking musical contrast. Here it is. At the last public performance of his music that Haydn went to, he was very ill, very old, carried in on a chair to actually hear this piece. And the reports are that when light was created, Haydn raised his hands to the heavens and tears were streaming down his face. It's an electrifying moment. Anyway, in the chorus that I want to play for you now, The Heavens Are Telling, Haydn will again use these kind of extreme contrasts. Not quite that extreme, but there's a lot of contrast in there. But he's also going to use some other means of summoning the sublime, these kind of lofty emotions and lofty, powerful feelings. For example, he will call up a kind of musical grandeur, a kind of magisterial sound, by using bright keys and trumpets and drums, full orchestration. And we hear this invocation of majesty at the beginning of this choral number. Let me play a little bit of that for you, just the beginning. Another means of summoning the musical sublime is to foreground a key moment of text, to repeat it or somehow set it off from the texture around it so that it really pops out of the music. And in the next little bit, he's going to do this on the word, in English it would be ever, but the German equivalent or parallel moment would be keiner. So what you'll hear actually is a kind of contrast, a sudden stop before the word keiner. And then after this little pause, this caressing melody that will just kind of touch the heaven as it kind of caresses its way back down. But what I want you to hear, where I've got it underlined, is he pretty much makes the word keiner, ever, just pop right out of the musical texture. Here's that moment. And in terms of musical structure or texture, counterpoint is particularly really big fugal passages is probably the most common way of summoning the sublime in music of this style. And in The Heavens Are Telling, in this chorus that I'm going to play for you now, there is a really long fugal passage about halfway through that takes us pretty much to the end. And this extended fugal passage demonstrates the final way that Haydn summons the sublime in this piece, the sublime as climax. So what you'll hear at the end of part one, the end of this chorus, with about 2 minutes left, is this kind of building through several passages of really intense counterpoint, fugal textures, and each becomes increasingly more chromatic, harmonically incomprehensible, until the music finally pushes through and finally cadences into kind of a clear moment for a final push to the end of the piece. A mere 14 bars before it's over. So halfway through, you're just going through this intense, sublime moment, 14 bars before the end, finally some clarity to end the work. Let me play you this final chorus. It's 3.5 minutes long, but I promise you, it's worth it. First of all, you can't understand the last 2 minutes of climax if you haven't had that little minute and a half to set you up. So here's that. So hopefully the musical examples that I've played will give you some sense of the local details in the piece and some sense of the large-scale organization. But to finish up, what I'd like to do is say a few words about the structure of the story and a bit about its reception history, because the reception history has become actually part of the story of the piece itself now. So in looking at the overall story of the libretto, following the opening representation of chaos, we have angels narrating the wonders of the natural world as God creates it day by day. And with each day, there are only more wonders and only more natural beauties for us to take in and appreciate, even though we haven't yet been created. But then once we are created, Adam and Eve discover the rich splendor of this newly created world along with their beautiful love for each other. This is an uplifting story. The emotional trajectory is entirely unidirectional. It's all up. Things only get better and better and better. Uriel, the angel, does offer one little warning just before the end, just a tiny one before the final chorus. But the creation ends, the oratorio stops, the bell rings before anyone gets curious, oh Eve, causes trouble, and gets expelled. So again, this is a really uplifting story. Okay. Well, forgive me for saying this, and I'm not the first to say it, certainly. The creation libretto may be a very positive, feel-good kind of story, but narratively speaking, I'm sorry, it's just not that good. I mean, it's lacking that one essential ingredient in good storytelling. You know what it is, right? Drama, surprise, conflict, tension. The story, a good story, requires a little bit of disorder. I mean, if not total chaos, a little bit of disorder. But in this telling of the story, certainly, we stop before, again, anyone gets in trouble. Once light is created, there's no darkness. There's no tension. There's no conflict. There's no drama. After the opening number, we move in a single positive direction for 2 hours. But what the piece might lack in its own drama has actually been amply supplied by its critics. For example, the textual style of the libretto, particularly the English libretto, has been under attack from the very beginning. Here's what happened. The libretto was in English, and then a German guy, the librettist, Baron von Swieten, who actually gets credit for writing it, translated that libretto into German and then adapted it for Haydn, the German-speaking composer, to set, and then translated it back to English, so we actually have a bilingual text, the first major piece of music with a bilingual text. Von Swieten's English was really not very good. So what we get are some lines that are rather absurd, like this one. Well, I mean, I look at this and I say, yeah, lions are tawny and, you know, stags can leap about and whatnot, but are tigers flexible? I mean, really? Are tigers flexible? Or how about this description of newly created man? The large and arched front sublime of wisdom deep declares the seat. What? Thankfully, Robert Shaw and Alice Parker altered this line and a lot of other ones in 1957 to read, thankfully, his broad and arching noble brow proclaims of wisdom's deep abode. Well, okay, at least that makes some sense. Haydn also faced inevitable comparison with Handel in England. There's just no way that the English public or the English press was going to find Haydn anything but inferior to their beloved Handel. And let's remember, Handel emigrated to England and made it his home. Haydn left after two trips and never came back. But beyond the comparison with Handel, Haydn's creation has been most widely criticized for its word painting, those wonderful depictions that you and I just enjoyed a few minutes ago. This piece was composed, perhaps unfortunately, right before the aesthetics of absolute music would take hold in the thought and writings of the early Romantics. And so from very early on in its reception history, critics took issue with the kind of musical pictorialisms that we just heard. So for example, Friedrich Wilhelm Joseph von Schelling wrote, "The illustrative, something only a debased and decadent taste can demand of music." That's not very nice. But for my money, the best one, the most scathing criticism, comes from Romantic composer Hector Berlioz, written about 20 years after he actually reviewed The Creation in print. Let me read this one out to you because it's worth it. This is Berlioz writing in a private letter. "The Conservatoire presented Haydn's Creation complete last Sunday. I stayed away. I have always felt a profound antipathy for this work. I give you that opinion for what it's worth. It's lowing oxen, it's buzzing insects, it's light in C, which dazzles one like a carcel lamp, and then it's Adam, Uriel, Gabriel, and the flute solos, and all the amiabilities really shrivel me up. They make me want to murder somebody. The English love a pudding surrounded with a layer of suet. I detest it. Suet is exactly what surrounds the musical pudding of Papa Haydn. Naivete is all very fine, but too much of it we don't need. I wouldn't give an apple for the privilege of meeting even the Woods. I am sure she is stupid enough to bring shame to the good God and is just what her husband deserves." So this little gem from Berlioz keeps a lot of company in the critical literature, even if the other reviewers and criticisms are not quite this delicious in their sense of humor. But more recently, two critics have helped us reevaluate the naturalisms in this piece. First of all, Charles Rosen, writing in his landmark book, The Classical Style, notes that the imposed simplicity of the pastoral style was the condition which made it possible to grasp subjects of such immensity. The subject of the pastoral is not nature itself, but man's relation to nature and what's natural. And even further, again, my friend and colleague Jim Webster argues that to understand the creation as pastoral, not so much sublime, but as pastoral, exposes many of the criticisms of the work as misguided. Basically, such complaints measure the oratorio, both its music and its story, against a romantic aesthetic of transcendence or overcoming. Think Beethoven. And against those kind of aesthetic expectations, the work's movement from the high style of the sublime and the chaos to the kind of buzzing insects and the worm, much, much more pastoral and lowly, this is going to no doubt prove anticlimactic. So to truly understand and appreciate Haydn's oratorio for the masterwork that it is, we can't measure it unfairly with anachronistic yardsticks. We need to remember that the creation was truly a product of the intellectual and political and religious contexts of the Enlightenment. And the Enlightenment was an optimistic but conservative philosophical worldview in which an unwavering commitment to the values of truth and reason and nature led to a belief in an unending human progress in all things, from scientific discovery to moral values. In other words, like the creation, the Enlightenment is unidirectional too. The philosophy and worldview of the Enlightenment does not deal directly with notions of difference in class or race or gender or religion, none of that. And neither does it probe the causes and consequences of human misery. The transcendence of those kinds of misfortunes and inequities, that's the stuff of romanticism, that aesthetic stance that's just around the corner in the 19th century. Rather, as one of the last musical testaments of the Enlightenment, once light has succeeded chaos and darkness has been replaced, Haydn's creation absorbs and dispels all such trials and tribulations with its unabashed and unwavering pastoral optimism. We live in a time of abundant cynicism and not a small amount of human guilt about the destruction of our world, particularly our beautiful natural world. And I've been known, anyway, I'll confess, to take momentary refuge and find true sublimity in the sheer naturalisms and pastoral and hopeful expressions of this music. And I'm hoping now perhaps you might as well. Thank you very much. I have 2:57, but I'm happy to have a conversation here as we can, or out in the hall later if people need to leave. But if anyone has comments or questions or complaints, happy to hear them. Yeah?
Was this written after, like, Beethoven's symphony?
It was written before. This is actually written just in the last decade of the of the 18th century. And it's about 10 years before. About 10 years before. At the very beginning, you mean? The first, you know, it's interesting. I know exactly what you're saying, and I hear it that way, too. It's actually just a unison C. There's no third to tell us either way. And I think what's doing that, and I think this is Haydn's intention, actually, what's doing that is the bizarre orchestration. Timbrally, it's very, very weird. I mean, we have the strings, the main players in the orchestra are muted. And then we have brass that's not quite in their range, and we have wind instruments that are straddling it in this kind of weird timpani role. It's a bizarre orchestration. So I think I hear it the way you do, even though I know there's no third in there to tell me otherwise. But I think it's that timbre that gives it that kind of ominous feeling. So even though musically he's not telling us either way, the orchestration, that subtlety is very important. I'm glad you hear it, because that's exactly how I hear it. And the other interesting thing, if you're hearing a little bit of Beethoven through there, Beethoven studied with Haydn. He did. Now, he claims after the fact not to have learned anything, didn't like it. but if you actually look through a lot of Beethoven's work, from the vantage point of knowing Haydn's work, I'm sorry, I see Haydn's fingerprints all over it. If you want to talk about that, I can bore you for like 3 hours out there on that one. But I hear what you're saying, and that sublimity of that opening chord, that's a pure romantic idea that Beethoven, of course, will take up and run with. Absolutely. Good comment. Other questions or comments? Yes?
What would have been the venue that this was initially presented? The
first performance was actually a private performance for aristocratic patrons in Vienna. So it was commissioned from Haydn for that kind of private performance. And then, I believe it was about a year later, it received its first public performance in Vienna, and then also in England and other places. But first, it was a group, a private society of basically, you know, aristocrats that commissioned the work from Haydn. No, this is, first of all, it's non-liturgical, and it would have been performed in concert spaces, not churches. An oratorio, one of the ways you can think about it is it's really very much sort of like an opera that is not staged on a sacred topic. Okay, so very often there's a story with characters. This one is a little different, but very often there's stories and characters, but we would perform it in a concert setting. We wouldn't run around and block it, if that makes sense. And it would be on a sacred topic. So, yeah, good question. Other questions? About, I think, a year and a half. And by his own admission, he struggled really hard with lots of it. When he went to England, he first encountered firsthand, really, a lot of performances of Handel's music. And he claimed it was overwhelming, and he basically had to sit down and kind of rethink and relearn everything that he ever knew about writing music. Coming into contact with Handel's music, one of the performances, over 1,000 musicians in Westminster performing in a Handel festival. So Haydn is there, hearing Handel's music, 1,000 musicians. And he's overwhelmed. And he goes, okay, I need to completely rethink this. Oh, now you're going to catch me. He's been in his 60s, I believe. Don't double check, I'm terrible at math. But he's an older man. He's not, you know, senile and decrepit yet, but he's getting there. He's older. And he's done traveling. I mean, he's in the end stages of his career. Other questions? Yes.
Well, Haydn was known to do a lot of firsts, right?
Yes. Yes.
I mean, was he the first to do animal equivalents or that's
actually something that kind of musical depictions or pictorialisms, that's something that really goes on through the 18th century. But the thing, and I don't want to say that he's the first, because I'd really want to double check that, but he, I think, is one of the, I would anyway, as a Haydn specialist, want to give him credit for being the first to make so much out of that reversal of hearing the animal or the phenomenon before naming it. Because I really think that is part of what he's saying in how we understand the meaning of this piece. So whether he's the first one to make that switch, I mean, the more obvious is, here's a dog, ruff, 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 you know, whatever. I mean, that's, you know, name it, play it. And then it's backwards. Again, I don't know if I could really comfortably say he's the first. He's probably not. But he gets so much, to me, interpretive mileage out of doing it that way. Putting us human beings in contact with those animals before they're named. And then also, I mean, there's a kind of biblical imperative here, because if you remember, we named them. So we have to have come into contact with them first and go, what should we call that? You know, so again, allowing us to kind of participate, perhaps, I mean, it's another way of thinking about that structural organization, whether it's putting us in contact with nature before we wreck it, perhaps, which is one of the ways I'm reading it in a kind of more optimistic viewpoint. But another kind of more literal way, we humans gave them their names. So we have to come into contact with them, even though we're not created yet, we have to come into contact with them before we can name them. So I think that's really what's unusual and perhaps a first in Haydn. He gets so much interpretive mileage out of that structure. I don't know if I answered your question at all, but anyway.
Also the pastoral, is that mm-hmm. is a concept? Did it start with him?
No, it's much earlier. It actually goes quite far back and easily into the 17th century, but basically as a literary genre that depicts rustic and rural, often shepherds and kind of sort of New Testament scenes, manger scenes, things like that. It's a common literary and musical genre that is used with these kind of rhythms, a kind of melancholy tone, wind instruments that are associated with the outdoors, also the sounds of the countryside. You think of horns and wind instruments, light, you know, the shepherd playing the flute, things like that. You're not going to have a cello out there in the field. So
I would say the Beethoven.
Yeah. Right? Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm. That seems so different.
It is. Although if you really think about it, he's going to use wind instruments the same way. He uses the key of F major, which goes flat side, which is much more conducive to a lot of wind instrument playing. And then also from a kind of C major center axis, F major is a step back. It's to the subdominant, which is a kind of more relaxed pose, where if you move to G or D, you're moving forward sharp side. So there's a kind of repose in his choice of key there. But aesthetically, we're in a different world. I mean, Beethoven, certainly by the pastoral, we've passed through the heroic style. We've passed through transcendence and overcoming. He knows he's going deaf. He's in an entirely different aesthetic and personal space than Haydn, who was the most famous and extremely wealthy composer in the land. He's sitting on top of the world. Beethoven's miserable. So we're coming from a very different place. So it really, but a good question. But the pastoral is a much bigger concept. I think I'm going to get kicked out. But if anyone wants to continue this conversation, I'm really happy to be outside for a bit. So thanks for coming. I appreciate it. Thanks. Oop, sorry. Class is over.